Quick recap. In the last class, we started discourse. Previously, we tried to define discourse in terms of a unit larger than a sentence. So we saw the examples from Halliday and Husson, and there were two sentences. And how there was a cohesion between those two sentences we saw. The sentences were like, wash and core 6 apples, put them in a bowl. And we said that there are two sentences. So it is creating a discourse that we discussed. At the same time, in the last class, we tried to define discourse etymologically, and we found the root of discourse in medieval Latin and in modern day Latin. At the same time, we also tried to define discourse based on the definitions provided in Collins Concise English Dictionary. And what we found that discourse is both oral communication as well as written communication. At the same time, we discuss that discourse is formal as well as discourse can be informal. But at the same time, we found certain perspective provided by linguists where they made a distinction between text and discourse. According to certain linguists, discourse is related to spoken communication, whereas text is related to written communication. We also find an archaic use of discourse as a verb, and the meaning is the ability to reason. We also find that to discourse upon or to discourse on is a phrasal verb that we have, and the meaning. So I start. We also discussed that discourse can also be used as a phrasal verb, and the meaning is to speak and write about formally or to hold a discussion. We discussed how linguists Geoffrey Leach and Michael Short, they made a distinction between discourse and text. They associated discourse with a spoken communication, whereas they associated text with a written communication. At the same time, what we found in the definitions provided by Leach and Short, that they associate discourse with a two-way communication, whereas when it comes to text, they defined it a one-way communication. This thing is quite peculiar in Leach and Short. We also discuss that how a clear-cut distinction has been made by Michael Stubbs, where text is related to written communication and discourse is related to spoken communication. At the same time, text is non-interactive, whereas discourse is interactive. So again, one-way communication, two-way communication is related to Michael Stubbs. Again, the same thing we found in David Crystal's, where he provided text analysis and discourse analysis, and he associated discourse analysis with spoken language, whereas text analysis is related to written language. At the same time, slightly modified view we found in Benveniste, where discourse is related to communication, and it is a larger unit. It is a larger unit than the sentence, and the distinction is made between language as communication and language as a system of sign. Now we will look at the French connection with this word discourse, and Benveniste characterizes discourse as the domain of communication, but goes on to contrast discourse with history or story, which is a distinction more finely developed in French than in English because of the use of different past tenses for formally narrating events and presenting events with a spoken frame of reference. So the one idea that is discourse is the domain of communication. Here in this idea, it is not specified whether discourse is a spoken communication or a written communication, but discourse is treated under the domain of communication. So here we find slightly a broad version of discourse, that discourse includes both spoken as well as written communication. The same thing we found in the dictionary definition. So Benveniste view is slightly broad and modified from the view of David Crystal, Michael Stubbs, and Leach and Short. But here we find another type of contrast, and the contrast is between discourse and the term history and story. That is the contrast that we find. Now, when you look at history or when you look at story, there is one peculiar thing that is common in history and in story. What is that one peculiar thing? The peculiar thing is they deal with past tenses. When we talk about history, then we are talking about past things. When we tell a story, then also we are dealing with past tenses. So this is the difference. The difference of tense and aspect that is there between discourse and history or story. Discourse will be dealing with the present tense, but whereas when it comes to history, when it comes to a story, then it is largely or always in past tense. So this is one very important distinction that is made by Benveniste, and because of its French connection, it is established quite clearly. So now we have a different type of contrast between tense and time, contrast between present tense and past tense. This is important to note. Second thing, every variety of oral discourse or every nature of trivial conversation to the most elaborate oration is discourse. So again, now Benveniste tries to find out that discourse is largely the part of oral discourse, and it includes both informal oral communication as well as formal oral communication. But it is also the mass of writing that reproduces oral discourse or that borrows its manner of expression and its purposes. Now, there is an extension, because we have seen that Benveniste characterizes discourse as the domain of communication. That means both oral and written communication. Here, Benveniste specifies that largely the mass of writing that different writers reproduce is actually a manner of expression that has been set in oral discourse, and now it is a reproduction. So the written communication is basically a reproduction of oral discourse. when it comes to novel writing. And if you look at what is novel writing, that means writer has something to say. Writer has something to say, but that writing in the form of a novel is simply a manner of expression. So it is not the case that what we write is cannot be said. That is the point Benvenist is making here, that whatever we write can also be said. So in a way, most of the written discourse is a reproduction of the oral conversation or oral communication. This is how Benvenist treats discourse. Further, Benvenist says, historical utterance is today reserved for the written language, but discourse is written as well as spoken. Finally, he has made himself very clear that discourse is both written and spoken, whereas when it comes to history writing, then historical utterance today is reserved for written language. So generally, most of the histories that you find, that is in written discourse. So it is not orally communicated. Previously, like thousands of years back, people used to tell history orally. So most of our scriptures, they were orally transmitted from one generation to another. So it is said that like Vedas, they were also transmitted orally. Now they are in the written form, but initially they were transmitted orally. So here Benvenist is also making one specific point, that historical utterance is today reserved for the written language. So today reserved from, but in the past they were also transmitted, they were also communicated orally. So this is how we find a French connection with this word discourse. To move further, Roger Fowler, he associates discourse with ideology. What he says, Fowler says, discourse is speech or writing seen from the point of view of the beliefs, values, and categories which it embodies. What does it mean? When you talk about a discourse and when you associate discourse with speech and writing, then whatever you say or whatever you said, that can be analyzed from the point of view of your beliefs, values, and categories. So whatever you said, that can be analyzed from a viewpoint that is related to some belief, some values, and some categories. This is basically the point, that it cannot be analyzed neutrally. That is, whatever you say, what type of statement you are making, that is related to some ideology. So what is ideology? The way of thinking that we have, and the way of thinking is based upon your beliefs, your values, and they fall under certain type of categories that they have. These beliefs constitute a way of looking at the world, an organization or representation of experience. Ideology in the neutral, non-pejorative sense. So here, this neutral, non-pejorative sense, this phrase is important, that whatever you experience, that is in neutral, non-pejorative sense. We are not taking into any negative connotative way. We are not saying that what are your beliefs are, your values are, categories are wrong or right. We are not saying that. But what is more important, even the most trivial things that you do in your day-to-day routine, in your day-to-day activity, those are also related to some ideology, some way. For example, if you get up at 6 o'clock, then there is again an ideology that why do you get up at 6 o'clock? Why do not you wake up at 10 o'clock in the morning? So you will raise the question, what type of ideology is related to this very trivial act of waking up or leaving the bed? The ideology is related to this Hinduism or Hindu way of living, that one should get up before the sunrise. So this is again, you're getting up, you're eating food. Someone says, I'm a pure vegetarian. So again, there is one ideological stand that why you are a pure vegetarian. Someone says, I am non-veg. Then again, there is some ideological stand that why you are a non-veg. So the bottom line is your day-to-day activities, your very trivial acts that you do daily, they are very much related to your beliefs, your values, and they can be categorized accordingly. So anything that you said, anything that you do, anything that you write, that is associated with certain sort of ideology. That is the belief of Roger Fowler. Different modes of discourse encode different representations of experience, and the source of these representation is the communicative context within which the discourse is embedded. Again, context comes into play. You want to find out why something is said, where something is said, who said that, then you need to look at the context appropriately. You need to look at context more carefully. Then you will realize the actual meaning. So different modes of discourse encode different representation of experience. And where can you find and how can you find these differences? When you look at the context more carefully, more critically, more closely. This is how Roger Fowler, he associates discourse and ideology. Then when you try to find out the meaning of the discourse, then it is always difficult. We have seen that there are lots of different definitions that are associated with the word discourse. Etymologically, you find discourse is associated with medieval Latin, present day Latin, and there is also a French connection with the word discourse. At the same time, different theorists who are associated with literary theory, who are associated with... Yes, so I continue. Yes, so we were discussing that why it is difficult to pin down the meaning of the word discourse, because discourse is associated with many disciplines. Discourse is associated with various roots in different languages, and the two roots we have discussed, one is the French connection and second one is the medieval Latin and modern day Latin connection that we have. Now, what Foucault says in this regard, when it comes to the meaningfulness of the word discourse, Foucault says, instead of gradually reducing the rather fluctuating meaning of the word discourse, I believe I have in fact added to its meaning, treating it sometimes as the general domain of all statements, sometimes as an individualizable group of statements, and sometimes as a regulated practice that accounts for a number of statements. Now here you find again a very broad definition of the word discourse. and Foucault associates discourse with general domain of all statements. That is general domain. There is no specific thing. Even if you are saying, okay, I'm going to attend a class. Okay, I'm going to eat my lunch. Okay, I'm going to have a nap. Fine. Or I'm going to a mall. These type of statements, if you make, okay, I'm tired now, I'm hungry, okay, it's not funny. All these are general domain of all statements. So these are general statements. So one type of discourse is like this, according to Foucault, where you make any type of statement, very trivial statement, important statement, every type of statement that you make, that is the part of general domain of all statement. That is one thing. Another thing is individualizable group of statements. Now, individualizable group of statements, and sometimes is a regulated practice that accounts for a number of statements. Now, two things are there. Now, regulated practice. When I say regulated practice, you are a part of a particular party. Party in a sense, a political party. You belong to a particular political party. You are not the active member of that political party, but still you believe that particular ideology. Then what happens? You, whatever the statement that you make, that is regulated. When I say regulated, that means you need to make your statements in favor of that party. So you need to make your political stand, your social stand in favor of. Let's say you are a feminist. So being a feminist, you can't say something against females. So this is a regulated practice. That is a regulated practice that you need to make. So similarly, you are a part of a religious body. You belong to a particular religion. Even you find that certain things are not correct, but still you are not that vocal. What is this? This entire thing is regulated practice. So this is the part of Foucault says, like, one part is general domain of all statements. That is one thing. And the second thing is regulated practice that accounts for a number of statements. Third thing is individualizable group of statement. So what is your individual perspective? That is nothing to do with the common statements. That means your personal view that comes under this. So there is a possibility that you are not related to, let's say you are an atheist. Fine, you don't belong to any religion, and then you are stating your point. At the same time, you are highly apolitical person, then you are stating your points. So in Foucault's definition, we find everything that you say, everything that you write. For example, there is a possibility that some of you are writing diaries. So that the diary writing is also comes under the general domain of all statements that you are making. So this is again a discourse. Diary writing is also a part of discourse that you have. So it's very, very broad, but at the same time, Foucault says that instead of gradually reducing the rather fluctuating meaning of the word discourse, Foucault says that I am not reducing the meaning of the word discourse. I am not again giving any another definition that will reduce the meaning of the word discourse that we found in Leach and Short, that we found in Michael Stubb, that we found in David Crystal. What they did, they tried to define it, and they reduce the meaning of the word discourse. But Foucault says, I am not doing that. That's why Foucault included all the three things, and in all the three things is under these three things, everything, whether a statement, oral statement, written statement, anything that comes under this. And this Foucault says in his book, The Archaeology of Knowledge, published in 1972. This is again important. So here we have an analysis of the three things that Foucault said: general domain of all statements. What is general domain of all statements? All utterances or text which have meaning and which have some effects in the real world count as discourse. So this is generally the meaning of general domain of all utterances or texts which have meaning. So it's like we are not talking about something that is nonsense, something that has no meaning, and something that has, that is an effect in the real world. Even if you say like if you say I'm going I'm going to sleep now. So again, this is an effect. Like you are informing someone, and the person will have some effect. So what is the effect? Person is at least informed. Okay, she is going to sleep now. So the person can say, okay, don't go. We want to sleep after some time. Or the person will say, okay, you go and I will sleep late. So that is a possibility. Or you are indicating that, okay, I'm going to sleep now. And what you are indicating that, okay, I'm going to switch off the lights. Then again, there is an effect in the real world. And person say, no, don't switch off the light now because I'm reading, I'm studying. So this is general domain of all statement. That is one. And individualizable group of statements, the particular structure within discourse which can identify that discourse. Group of utterances which seem to be regulated in some way and which seem to have a coherence and a force to them in common. For example, a discourse of femininity, a discourse of imperialism. So these type of are also the part of art of discourse. Basically, in 2 and 3, you won't find much difference regulated, because a discourse of femininity is again a regulated practice. A discourse of imperialism is also a regulated practice. So there is no very clear-cut distinction between an individualizable group of statements and a regulated practice which accounts for a number of statements. So a regulated nature of discourse and the rules and structures behind actual utterances. Here, rule and structures behind actual utterances and text.